Cinemachine has been used when creating amazing games, including Death's Door, A Short Hike, and many more in Unity, who actually became the sponsor of this video after I shared it with the team. Thank you to Unity for the support and for creating Cinemachine. Since learning about this package, it has become my first download when starting any new project. If you also fall in love with Cinemachine after watching this video and want to continue your learning, check out the fantastic Cinemachine documentation or my other videos on the subject. I'll provide links in the description. When it comes to third-person cameras in Unity, look no further than what Cinemachine has to offer. Today we will break down everything that you need to know about one of our options, Cinemachine's free look camera. My name's Nikki, this channel is iHeartGameDev, and now, let's get started. Cinemachine can be downloaded for free from the package manager. And once downloaded, provides a suite of pre-built cameras like the FreeLook camera. Similar to all Cinemachine cameras, in order to use the FreeLook camera, a Cinemachine brain component is required to be attached to the standard Unity camera in the scene. The brain then overrides the Unity camera's values with the active Cinemachine camera's values. Now, when first entering play mode using the FreeLook camera's default settings, nothing happens. The FreeLook camera requires a target, like Jammo from the hit YouTube channel Mix and Jam. When a game object from the hierarchy is set as the follow target, the FreeLook camera automatically positions itself closer to the target, and it will stay within that distance as the game object moves around. Also, debug lines now showcase the FreeLook camera's full setup. The FreeLook camera is broken down into three rigs. Each rig is a customizable circle that sits horizontally on the XZ plane. Connecting all three rigs is a spleen angled on the Y axis that the camera's movement is tethered to. This combination of the three rigs and the spleen allows the camera to be positioned anywhere on the surface area generated from the setup, granting the player complete orbital movement around the follow target. With the follow property set, moving the mouse or right control stick will orbit the camera around the target, in this case around Jammo. However, the camera's direction remains static, meaning the target isn't always in the camera's view. That's not ideal for a third-person camera. How do we fix it? The look at target determines what the focus of the camera should be, aka what the camera should always be pointed towards. Similar to the follow property, drag in a game object from the hierarchy to set it as the target. With both the follow and look at target set, the camera will now properly orbit around the target and it will always remain in view. If using the new input system, a warning will likely show up in the inspector stating that the system is installed and an input provider will need to be added to handle the controlling of the camera. A button is provided to automatically create a default input provider and fix the issue. Alternatively, this input provider can be created and set ourselves. Cool. Now to customize the camera. Looking at the inspector, we'll see a ton of options that the FreeLook camera provides. This top section is available to all Cinemachine cameras. Status will display live if the camera is in use, standby if the camera is active but not in use, or disabled if the camera game object is disabled. Pressing solo will automatically make the camera live, so we can easily make adjustments and see what those changes are. Activate the Save During Gameplay property to make changes to this list while in play mode. When active, the Game Window Guides toggle provides a visualization of each rig's settings. If there are multiple cameras in the scene, setting the priority determines which Cinemachine camera should be live or in use. The camera with the highest priority determines which camera's values will be used when the Cinemachine brain overrides the Unity camera. Standby update determines if the camera should move and rotate with its target when it is not the active Cinemachine camera. Never means that it won't, always means it will every frame, and round robin means it will every few frames. The common lens checkbox allows us to customize the camera's field of view for all three rigs, as well as the clipping planes and Dutch, aka the distances that are rendered through the camera and the camera's tilt. The transitions dropdown includes blend hint, inherit position, and a list for custom callbacks for when the camera becomes active. Blend hint provides three options that allow a bit of customization on the camera movement when the active camera switches. Inherit position places the camera at the same point as the unity camera when the transition occurs, or in the case of the freeload camera, as close to that point as possible. And the callbacks are customizable functions that will be invoked when the camera is activated. For even more information on these standard camera settings, check out How to Use Cameras in Unity Cinemachine Virtual Cameras Explained on the channel. But now, the freeload camera has a set of specific properties to help customize how it works. Often found in the settings of released games, this first set of lists under axis control customize the sensitivity of camera movement and provide awesome functionality options. Input axis value is the user input that is received and processed to actually move the camera around the target. The y-axis value is a normalized number between 0 and 1, which represents the position between the three freeload rigs. 0 for the bottom, 0.5 for the middle, and 1 means the top. The default position is 0.5. And if y-axis recentering is enabled, the camera will reposition back to the middle rig if there is no user input after the provided wait time. Modify the recentering time to speed the recentering up or slow it down. Speaking of speed, the speed properties provide a max speed per second that the camera can move on the given axis. Remember that the y-axis is a value between 0 and 1, so the default value of 2 means that it will take half a second to move from the bottom rig to the top. Whereas the x-axis is in degrees, so if set to 300, it will be moving at 300 degrees per second. Modify the acceleration and deceleration properties to change the responsiveness of the camera to the user input, and invert each axis input with their respective invert checkboxes. In order to access the additional heading and recenter to target heading lists, and the value range properties and wrap toggle of the x-axis, change the binding mode of the orbit settings to anything but the default simple follow with world up. Limit the rotation of the camera around the target by changing the value range, and prevent the camera from completing the full rotation by disabling the wrap toggle. Recenter to target heading should look familiar. It's a duplicate of the y-axis recentering, except it handles recentering on the x-axis. The difference is that this recenter point changes. It's determined by the heading list definition property. The definition property includes position delta, velocity, target forward, and world forward. Using position delta, the camera will recenter and point toward the direction that the game object is moving. More specifically, it's defined by the change in position between the current and previous frames. Velocity will do the same thing, but based on the rigid body component attached to the target. Position filter strength essentially delays this calculation a few frames to help ignore jittery movement input. And bias provides an offset to this heading direction. Target forward will set the heading direction to the Z forward vector of the game object. And world forward will set it to the Z forward vector of world space. Okay, the orbit settings are critical for customizing the freeload rigs in Spleen. Increase or decrease the height of each rig to modify the spacing between the rigs, and update the radius to grow and shrink the distance from a given rig to the follow target. And spleen curvature will make the path between rigs more or less direct. The binding modes determine how the camera will respond to rotations of the follow target. Each option responds differently. With lock to target on assign, The camera will adjust to the rotations on the X, Y, and Z axes when the follow target is first set, but proceed to ignore any changes to the target rotation. Locked to target with world up, the camera ignores rotations on the X and Z axes, but rotates on the Y axis. Locked to target no roll ignores rotations on the Z axis, but rotates on the X and Y axes. Locked to target continuously follows rotations on all axes. World space will ignore all rotations of the target, as will simple follow with world up. Each of the three rigs has exclusive properties under body and aim dropdown lists. Body is associated with the follow property, and for the Freela camera is locked to orbital transposer. Modify each damping property to adjust how quickly the rig attempts to reposition itself back to the expected distance from the target. The expected distance is the location of the camera sitting on the surface of the rig. And depending on which binding mode is selected, damping for pitch, yaw, and roll are available as well, which follow the target's rotation. Each rig also includes override properties for the look at target property, which can switch the camera's focus to a separate target. And it also includes separate lens properties, which were mentioned earlier, that customize the actual view of the camera. The final list of properties come from the selectable aim dropdown. The default setting is Composer, which will try to keep the target in view and provide a large list of settings. Adjust the tracking offset to shift the camera's view target. Look ahead time considers the target's direction of movement to best predict and project where the camera should be. Adjusting the smooth property can remove stuttery camera movement. And completely ignore movement on the Y axis with the ignore Y checkbox. Damping, once again, adjusts how quickly the rig attempts to reposition itself. Adjusting the screen X and screen Y values determines where the target is supposed to be placed on the screen. In order to see the different zones, be sure the Game Window Guide toggle is active. Dead zone means that the camera will not adjust if the camera is within the bounds. Soft zone means that the camera will try to reposition so that the target is back within the dead zone. The red zones are where the camera will never reach. And the bias will shift the soft zone position horizontally and vertically. Check center on activate to have the target positioned at the camera center if it was previously deactivated. The group composer requires a group target. It contains most of the same properties as the composer and additional exclusive group-related properties. Group framing size will adjust the camera's field of view within the minimax FOV values to best fit the bounding box of the targets. Its value is a percentage of the screen, one meaning 100% of the screen. Framing mode determines which screen dimensions, horizontal, vertical, or both, the camera should consider when attempting to fit its targets. Adjustment mode determines the path that the camera will take to recenter the targets of the group. Zoom, dolly, or dolly and zoom take different paths to tracking the targets. And the min and max field of view sets how wide or narrow of an angle the camera can use to view its targets. Hard look at removes the properties, but the camera will always remain focused on its target. POV stands for point of view. It has horizontal and vertical input properties, same as the orbital transposer, so getting these to work together will take quite a bit of work. Same as follow target will override the camera's rotation to match the follow target's rotations. And noise can be used to generate some camera shake patterns. Now, go play with all these settings to create an awesome third-person camera. Be on the lookout for a new video where we use the Freela camera to recreate the amazing camera controls of Super Mario. Thank you, as always, to the patrons for supporting this channel and helping to make each video happen. If you'd like access to project files, voting rights on future tutorials, and more, please consider supporting the channel over on Patreon. And a special shout out to Zach Etier, One Beach, and Ruben Cueto for their top tier support. Pop on over to the channel Discord if you're interested in joining an awesome growing community of developers just like yourself. Feel free to follow me on Twitter for updates on the next video. But that is all for today. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.